So that's something I'm still working on. But I do think it's interesting. Even if they were going to try to, you know, make it more of a debate style interview, she's okay. But to not that situation, I feel bad being in it, really. You know, just trying to come
around. I have a hard time keeping. I mean, I'm trepidatious.
Yeah, me too.
Well, let's see what they do.
Yeah, and I was actually interested in CNN last night. Like, I was kind of hoping they could do something interesting there, like a little more earlier CNN style. And
we are so grateful that you are here today. Just a couple of things before we get started. There is a red Chevy Sonic outside, and there's a dog in the car, and it's a little hot outside. So if that's your car, or if it's, you know, a friend or someone here that you know that has that car, we would love for you to go and help us with the dog out. Like I said, we are so grateful that you are here today to help support Hardwired Global. As we know, we have a special guest, Kathy Ireland. She will be joining us in just a couple of minutes. But first, I'd like to introduce our moderator, who is going to be facilitating the conversation between Tina and Kathy about our Peaceful Garden Project Education Initiative. So here with us today moderating the conversation is Rebecca Downs. Rebecca Downs is a native from Long Island and currently lives in Northern Virginia. She earned her BA in history from Fordham University and her MA in American Government, as well as a certificate in law and public policy from Regent University. She has been with Town Hall since March 2021, where she writes about all topics, but has a particular passion for covering Congress. In the 10 years she has worked in journalism, the pro-life issue and religious freedom has been her first and longest love. She is also the author of the Love, Politics, and Survival book series published under the pen name of Rebecca Rose. Thank you so much for being here, Rebecca. Join me in welcoming Tina and Kathy.
thank you so much. It's such a joy to be here. And thank you, everyone, for being here and supporting the work of Hardwired Global. It's so close to my heart. So in answer to your question, it was 2014, and my mom and I had a Bible study, and around our kitchen table, we had been, the women in our Bible study, we had been praying for Marion Aberdeen, and like people all around the world, and our hearts were just crushed over the atrocities going on. We think about, in our country, persecution that people face, we think about whether it's Christians, anti-Semitism, every kind of hatred, yet in other parts of the world, people are losing their lives. And our hearts were so filled when Miriam was free. We didn't really understand all of how that happened. We're so grateful. And yet, at the same time, there was so much going on in the world and devastating. And I was at a point where we were really just praying about, okay, how do we respond? What are we supposed to do? And I didn't know. And as I was praying about it, a friend of mine called. And she said, her name is Joy Bollinger, and she's just one of those people who, she would never ask me to come and do anything that wasn't meaningful. She's like, Kathy, you've got to come have coffee with me. I met this amazing woman. That was all I heard. I was like, okay, I know it's, you know, but I had no idea. So I'm sitting in the little restaurant, and in walks Tina, beautifully pregnant with Abigail. And it was just like, I'm so happy to know you. Who are you? What, you know, I knew nothing about Tina. And as she spoke, my breath was taken away. And I was so encouraged. It was an answer to my prayer, because I learned that through Tina's work with Hardwired Global, that was instrumental in getting Miriam free. That was so powerful. And we were talking, we had this amazing time. I knew Tina was going to be a friend forever. We just had to know more about this amazing woman. And she said, oh, yeah, we're going to go up, you know, at least one more time before the baby's born. And anyway, that was the beginning. And that was learning, and as I came to know Tina and understood how she gets the results that she gets. That's good.
And she does get her results.
Absolutely.
Yeah. And so why is religious freedom something that matters to you personally?
Religious freedom is of critical importance. I mean, I believe it's something that we have to fight for mm-hmm. everyone, regardless of belief. And when we experience the genocides, the atrocities that take place around the world, we recognize how crucially important this is. And I'm free to talk about my Christian faith without fear of persecution because of the work of people like Tina, Hardwired Global, fighting for that. So that's something that we cannot take for granted. It's something that we must protect. The Holocaust, I mean, when we think about anti-Semitism on the rise exponentially around the globe, here in our own country and around the world, when we think about the Uyghur Muslims being killed and persecuted because of their faith, when we think about the Yazidi people, people in Afghanistan, in Burma, around the world, in Iraq, it's, we've got to have that freedom, the freedom to believe. And something that Hardwired Global teaches and advocates for is that this is a God-given right, and according to the Universal Declaration of Human Rights of 1948, Article 18, every person has the right to freedom of thought, conscience, and religion, and it's something that we've got to fight for.
Mm-hmm. So So Tina, can you tell me more about what you were doing in Sudan and how Fireside got started?
What I was doing, or why I was so pregnant there.
Yes.
Well, at the time, unfortunately, as Kathy mentioned, this woman was imprisoned and she needed her freedom. I mean, it was essential. And so I had been training leaders in Sudan for a couple of years to defend religious freedom. And this was after the South had seceded and the North had a new, you know, was trying to rewrite its constitution, and Omar al-Bashir, the dictator, the butcher of Sudan, was still in charge. And the people wanted to find a path forward to have freedom, but they didn't know how. So we began to train leaders to develop legal protections in their constitution for their freedom. I mean, it's easy here in America to take this freedom for granted because it's been so ingrained in our constitution, in our founding documents for, you know, generations. But for many people in the world, in fact, for about 89% of the world population, they don't have that freedom. They don't understand it. It's not their constitution. It's not part of their culture. And that was the case in Sudan. So Miriam was literally sentenced to death because her husband was a Muslim, and so under the law, because her father was a Muslim, and under the law, because her father was a Muslim, she was then therefore declared Muslim and had no right to marry a Christian man. And so they actually accused her of adultery for marrying a Christian, because that was against the law, and they gave her 100 lashes. And then she tried to defend herself and say, well, actually, I'm a Christian, and I married a Christian because I'm a Christian. They said, we don't have a right to do that. Now that you're saying that you're not a Muslim, that you're a Christian, that's actually blasphemy, and we're going to give you the death sentence. So this woman, who was literally 8 months pregnant at the time, was put in prison, 2 feet below the ground, in a hot, dingy cell in Sudan, chained to the floor. I don't know why you would chain a pregnant woman to the floor. I would run, but maybe they thought someone would. And her 17-month-old son was in prison with her, and every day the imams would come and would force her to recant her faith. And every day she refused, and we trained the leaders that stood by her side and said, you're going to have a right to believe what you want. They were actually all Muslim lawyers, and they said, we will defend you to death. And they did, and the people outside the courthouse that held up signs saying, we are Miriam, this isn't Islam, she deserves her religious freedom, were all Muslim students that we had, that the people we had trained and trained, so over many generations. And they stood up for her freedom because they believed that she deserved the freedom to live according to her conscience, even if they don't believe the same thing. And that's something that's inspired me in my life, you know, throughout my life. I learned it from my father, and I believe that she deserved that freedom as well. So that's why we've been training leaders in other countries like Sudan, because Miriam wasn't hardwired to be imprisoned for her faith, to be forced to recant. She was hardwired to be free, just like you and I and Kathy. And that's the freedom she deserved. So I was going to fight to give her that freedom and to help raise up leaders that were willing to go against, you know, anything that they believe, to be willing to say, I believe that everybody deserves this freedom of conscience, even if I believe differently. That is a human right, as Kathy shared. And so that's what inspired me. That's what gave me the idea for this idea of hardwired, because I believe it's this freedom is hardwired into each of us, and that our freedom of conscience really is our most fundamental right. Without it, you don't have a free society. And so it is essential to be standing up and fighting for, you know, at every point around the world. And that's what I've done for people. In many different situations, yes, even while pregnant in the middle of Sudan, Iraq, and many other countries. But, you know, I have a 7-year-old daughter now. And when I was pregnant, you know, Kathy knew her before she came out. And I want my daughter to grow up in a free society, a free world, in a better world. And the reality is, as you look around, as Kathy shared, with all of the genocides and conflicts going on around the world, many of them being religion-related conflicts, if we don't have this freedom protected, if we don't have cultures that respect it, what kind of world is my daughter going to grow up in? And now here in America, a country that should understand these things, we're dealing with the same challenges. And so that's why being here today is so important, and the work we're doing. Mm-hmm.
So Kathy, you've been really involved with hardwired work in Iraq, which you touched upon a bit. Including a campaign called the Brave Ones that helped some of the Yazidi girls who were persecuted in Iraq. Can you tell me more about that?
Yes. So Tina and her team, they brought this young woman, Bazi, from Iraq, a Yazidi woman who had been captured by ISIS, an American ISIS. And Tina brought Bazi back so that she would be able to share her story to help other young girls and to help make some change. change in our policies and our government, because this was an American ISIS, to really make some big sweeping changes. And we had the privilege of meeting this young woman, beautiful. We first met at an event in Palisades, and then this friend that I mentioned, we had the privilege of hosting Nazi, and the community came out. We had a translator with us. So we were able to hear her story, and we were able to find out from her how we could pray for her. Bozzy, when ISIS came through, they killed her mother and father, and they shot her brother, left him for dead. He was thrown into one of those open graves. Her little three-year-old brother was taken into Jahari school, where he was, they sought to brainwash him. And Bozzy was taken captive. She was able to escape and share her story. Powerful, heartbreaking, yet encouraging to see the work that was going on. But we kept in touch with Bozzy. Tina was able to make some powerful and very needed changes. Tina and I were just talking today. There was a text that came up shortly after we met Bozzy, and it was in Arabic. And I was going crazy trying to find somebody who could translate it for me. And I was just having a busy day of being mom and life and everything, and I was picking up some food for our dog in between soccer games. And I heard this gentleman who was preparing the food, I heard an accent, and just said, "Excuse me, where are you from?" And he was from Syria. I said, "Do you speak and read Arabic?" And he said, "Yes." He's like, "Will you read this for me?" And this man, his name is Rami, he read the text, his face just dropped. He was just like, what is this? It says, "My mother was found in an open grave. And how can I live without my mother? And, ISIS did this." And he said, "They did that. Did that to my father." He had escaped. His father was killed bringing supplies to a church in Syria. And Tina, again, her team brought Bozzy and her brother, who was shot and left for dead in an open grave. He was able to escape. They brought him out and gave them, just wonderful opportunities here, and ultimately they chose to go back. They went to Germany. They had just relations there, and had the privilege of connecting with Bozzy about a year ago on a FaceTime call, and she is now happily married, got a little baby, a little child, and she's doing well, and that's encouraging.
That's wonderful. It sounds like a lot of providence is involved too.
Yeah.
So Tina, can you tell me more about Bozzy, the Brave Ones campaign, and your work in Iraq?
Yeah, I think Kathy described Bozzy's story so well. Bozzy's story is one of about 6,000 stories in Iraq. She was, one of the few that were able to escape the horrors. When I was in Iraq, I was there literally 2 weeks after the genocide started, and so I was in the area with these Yazidi leaders that was trying to rescue some of their girls, and girls would call them on the phone and just would say, "Please just bomb us, just put us out on the street," because ISIS had separated all the girls after they killed everybody. There were 58 mass graves of bodies of men of anyone of fighting age that they murdered. They put these mass graves, including the second mom and dad. wanted those girls to know how valuable they are, that they do have fundamental rights and dignity. And sadly, today in our country, we have people trying to teach our children that our dignity or value is somehow determined or predetermined by our socioeconomic outcomes or the color of skin. That's not what I learned in human rights. Your dignity and value is determined by an inherent fundamental freedom that you have because you have individual rights. And so that's what we want these girls to understand. And so Kathy was a huge part of helping us with the Brave Ones campaign and making it, bringing awareness to the easy plight nationally and getting the legislation passed. And we took Bozzy, she actually testified at the United Nations as well as the U.S. Congress, and so it was a huge part of this. Bozzy is obviously her pseudonym. And then, in addition to that, we recognize an enormous need because, as Kathy mentioned, the children that were held captive by ISIS or in the areas controlled by ISIS were also being brainwashed and radicalized into their hateful ideology. They were being taught how to hate and kill people in different ways. Many of these elite kids were being taught to follow an ISIS ideology that had nothing to do with their own faith and culture, and it really undermined their family, their heritage, their values, their culture. So we knew that when ISIS was defeated, that we needed to go and help those kids to get them back, to help them recover from what they had been taught. And so we, even before ISIS was defeated, we began working in the refugee camp with teachers and educators to prepare them and train them to teach the children, to teach them human rights and religious freedom, the same ideas that we taught to the Brave Ones, these girls that escaped their families. And so that's what we ended up doing. And then when ISIS was defeated, these teachers went back into Mosul and the Middle Plains. They went back and they taught the children how to overcome. And the peaceful garden story that we shared earlier today with the children, Kathy Resta, here at the library, was a story inspired by that. And I'd be happy to share with you. But that's the work that we're doing in Iraq. So we are now, through the work that we've done, both with the leaders of the civil society and government level, all the way down to educators across the board, the government has invited us to train every child in northern Iraq, in Mosul and the Netherlands, in our curriculum. So we have over 40 schools now that are mobilized that are teaching the curriculum and these lessons, and that are teaching their children in different ways. They're breaking through these, like, 2,000 years of hatred and cycles of conflict that, you know, people ask, well, is there any hope for the Middle East? Because you've seen this going on and on and on. When you see what is happening to these children in Iraq, it is so powerful and it is so encouraging because there is a way forward. We're seeing it.
And I think that's what we're going to bring you a statement on that too. But Kathy, so since education is something you're really passionate about as well, can you tell me more about her work, Hardwired's program at that school? You had a little bit about that school and how the kids responded. And also, you have two daughters who participated as well. So how did it impact their lives?
Well, your first question about the school and all of that, I was so amazed when I heard Tina's story. Okay, she goes to Iraq, she gets a Muslim imam, she gets a Yazidi leader, a Jewish rabbi, a Christian pastor, she gets all these people, such diversity, she trains them, and there are these incredible results. Like, how do you even bring these people together? Like, I wanted to learn more. And Tina's like, well, I'll show you. And my husband and I, along with Randy Clark, are founding members of a Christian school in our community called Providence. It started as a high school today. It's pre-K through grade 12. And Tina came and got the kids all together, and she did her training. And in the course of, it was about an hour, and like, it's gonna be a crash course because we don't have a lot of time for the, the school had all these things going on. Yet, what we experienced in that short time, it was transformational. The kids got it. Their eyes were open. They were engaged. They understood. And it just so clearly demonstrates the value and the dignity of each person, and that we deserve to be treated with that respect and that dignity. And that was amazing. And then our daughters, Lily and Chloe, both interned with Hardwired Global and loved it. What powerful experiences and just Lily worked on the Brave Ones campaign, and Chloe worked interviewing people, sharing their stories of what it means to live in America where there is freedom, and we can't ever take that for granted, and people coming from different countries where that wasn't the case.
Mm-hmm. And Tina certainly has a commanding presence. So I have no doubt that helped. So Tina, we did talk a little bit about the Peaceful Garden. Can you tell more about the Peaceful Garden project and how it relates to here in the United States?
Yeah, and really what we did at Catholic school like 6 or 7 years ago was a crash course that we hoped to bring to the United States, and we just didn't think that the situation would require it so quickly. Mm-hmm. And it's unfortunate that we've gotten to that point. But the Peaceful Garden project is really inspired by a book that we wrote called Peaceful Garden. It's over there, and we'll take a look at all the books and get some. And this was a story written by two Yazidi teachers who participated in our training. They were the first ones. They had fled from ISIS. And they had actually participated in trainings even before in our civil society training. So then we said, hey, we have this educational one. We'd love for you to participate and pilot something with us. So they did. And they developed this just amazing lesson around bringing their students to a garden. And these were students in the refugee camps that had all been displaced. They're all from different backgrounds and beliefs. And they brought them to a garden, and they said, now go make a bouquet of flowers, but just don't choose this one color. So the kids went, they made their bouquets. They're super excited. They came back, as most kids are. They showed their bouquets, but the teachers obviously had another lesson for them. They said, now look back at what happened to the garden. So the kids looked back, and they realized that they had destroyed the garden. I mean, they had ransacked it. It was just not beautiful at all. It was pretty decimated. And the teacher said to them, this is what happened in our country when ISIS came in. They destroyed everyone except for the people who looked and believed like them. And at that moment, the kids, from all these, they had experienced being forced from their homes because of ISIS, really got very tearful and emotional. And the teacher said, do you like the other garden better? And they said, of course, yes. And the teacher said, well, will you help us replant? And so they did. So they gave them seeds, and these kids worked together over the course of several months, replanted the garden and tended it together. But in that time that they worked together, they began to overcome their deepest differences and fears of one another. At the end, one Yazidi boy said, well, I got almost into like ISIS, but I realized that this boy here was forced from his home just like me. And it was such a powerful lesson that the government, one of our leaders, that Kathy wrote about in USA Today, Marwan Naqshbandi, a wonderful friend of mine, he was the leader of the Religious Affairs Ministry in Kurdistan, and he said, Tina, I want this lesson in every school. Every student needs to hear this lesson. And so that then opened the doors for us throughout Mosul and then the Plains to then be sharing this message of how can we overcome our deepest differences and fears of one another, our misperceptions, our prejudgments. How can we live together in peace and have hope for our future? And that's really what the Peaceful Garden Project is all about, is can we live together in peace if we believe differently? Just because we believe differently, does that make us enemies? Or can we not make our differences flashpoints of conflict, but rather areas of discussion and opportunity to find a path forward where we respect the dignity and freedom of others to believe differently and still live together in peace? So that was the Peaceful Garden Project, and that's what was inspired from it. We're really just excited that we get to bring that story here to children that need to know the same lessons. And these ideas are universal, as Kathy said. This is not just for children there. You know, America was founded as one of the greatest pluralistic experiments in the world, and founded on religious freedom and the freedom for people to believe differently and not be enemies. And I want that to continue. And I know that right now our kids need to know that. So we're really excited about bringing that here.
And can you go more into like how it exactly will work, like what it looks like, and what you are going to be doing?
Yeah, so just as we piloted it in Catholic school many years ago, we have decided by today, with this launch, to provide educational training opportunities for teachers, parents, educators across the United States to be able to participate in our training program and learn how to teach our fundamental rights and freedoms to children across the United States. To translate these values to them, we've seen what works in some of the worst situations in the world. And we know that if it can work there, it can work here. And in a country especially that is founded upon these freedoms, why not?
Yeah. why you think it's important for these lessons and Hardwire's education program to be taught here at Well. And as you did mention, there was an article you yourself wrote about Hardwire in USA Today, if you want to expand upon that as well.
Thank you so much. So much fun to read to the children. What a great group of energetic, enthusiastic children. They love the book. It's a great book. It's for every age. I mean, these children were young, and it had their attention all the way through. This is a program, I believe, what Hardwire Global does around the world. I mean, we're talking about generations of hatred and genocide, and we're seeing that. Just turn around. And when we look at what goes on in our own country, whether it's bullying in schools or with adults who are behaving badly, and when we look at agendas where there are some who want everyone to think the same and to believe the same, this just shines a bright light on that and says, no, you have the right to think the way you want to believe, to worship the way you want to. You cannot be forced. God gives us that freedom, and it should not be taken away. So I believe it needs to be for the kids, but also the adults need it to learn how to get along and live in peace with one another in times of conflict, and not to be afraid of it, and no shame in, I mean, for a child to feel shame in something as sacred as their faith and their beliefs, that's devastating, so that can't be.
Mm-hmm. Tina, so you had this vision for Hardwired and helping people experience greater freedom. It started in childhood places that we just discussed, like Sudan and Iraq, but as we've also discussed, these are lessons that people need to hear everywhere in the world. So it's amazing to see how the kids regard it as something that children everywhere can embrace. But we'd also like to know how we, the general public, and anyone listening can help make your book a reality. What can they do?
Well, thank you, Rebecca. So that's why we're here. I mean, we want people to have resources. I think it's often that we see in the media people attacking one another or talking about what's wrong. And I want to be part of the solution and say, look, we've seen something work in a really difficult place. We have solutions. And we think that this will work here too. I was a teacher, so I'm not just coming at this as, you know, for a policy person or, you know, human rights person. Actually, I was a teacher in a junior high and high school with students. And I got to see them actually be transformed by this. I had a young, it's actually very relevant today. I had a young Afghan boy in my class. Over 20 years ago, 2000 was my first year of teaching, and so it was pre-9/11, and this young Afghan boy used to go around beating everybody up. And he's a little kid, but he's smarter than me, but he beat everybody up. And I'm like, I don't want to say his name, but I said, can you, you know, what's going on? Anyway, we began to teach him. I taught the U.S. Constitution and our inalienable rights. I taught human rights, and I taught these fundamental values, and we actually were through my master's at the time in international human rights, so I incorporated that, and I began to see by the end of the school year, he was different. He was a different kid. And at the end of the school, they had to do these different projects, and he did his on the women in Afghanistan. They were being stoned to death at the time. You know, and as you may recall, Buddhist culture was being destroyed in Afghanistan. He wrote a letter to then President Bush, and he said, President Bush, will you please help these women? They're like birds in a cage that can't speak. We give them books. Will you help them? And something in him changed. This little boy, through these inalienable rights, these ideals of freedom that are ingrained in our country, learned how to value the dignity and freedom of others. And so over 20 years ago, I saw what worked. And I've seen what works in Catholic school and in Sudan and Iraq and all these other countries. And I believe that today, our children need to embrace those really fundamental ideas that found our country that lead us to treat people with greater dignity and respect. Mm-hmm. And I think that is the solution to the challenges we're facing today. I don't think it's shutting down freedom of speech and conscience and belief and telling people that their outcomes are predetermined by the color of their skin. I don't think that. I don't want my daughter to know that. So for parents, for educators, for people that are concerned in the community, I want them to have a resource. So we have our children's books. We have our our training program. And importantly, today we're here to raise money to provide the resources so that we can go out and do this training across the United States. Now, Hardwired over the last several months has been working with refugee students here in Virginia. And we've been bringing refugee students and American students together to understand how to overcome their differences and the misperceptions that might have with one another, to learn how to not self-isolate, but to actually interact and engage with one another, and learn how to be a part of the same community and respect one another's differences of opinion and belief and culture, and how to understand and embrace the values that we have here, the freedoms we have here, that they have to flee to find. And so it's remarkable to see the change that's happening in the community, and this is just a small microcosm of what needs to happen across the United States. We have the ability to do it, we just need the resources. And so that's what we're here today, is to ask people to be inspired by what's happening and to be a part of the solution with us.
And I just have to interject, the how is always of the utmost importance for myself and for our team at work, how things are done. And you can be a great person and you can have a great cause and maybe not a great business person and not willing to learn or step up. The stewardship of Tina and Hardwired Global is amazing, and what Tina is able to do, what I've experienced with a very lean budget is amazing, and what can be accomplished is so encouraging. So I feel honored to thank all of you for supporting Hardwired Global. I'm from the deepest part of my heart, thank you. And I encourage all of us to keep our eyes open, our hearts open, and our pockets open to give and support. This is life-changing, it's transformational. When we see people who, with different agendas, seeking to cause division in families with children, this is an educational program that is bringing people together in love and peace. It's beautiful. I've experienced the results, and I've experienced the amazing stewardship and the great house, and it's amazing. So thank you all for being here and supporting this.
And I should just say, Rebecca, we actually have some of the, so my mother, who I'm not sure if she's for that or she was, but was a huge part of taking the lessons that these teachers wrote around, turning them into stories, because I'm not a writer, I read a little bit, but this it's hard to create children's books. So my mother, who's in the back, is a huge part of that, and then Lynn Thomas, who's also here in the back, is a huge part of that, and then a friend of mine who illustrated the Jordan books, who's not with us. So this was a collaborative project, and we want to do more of that and be able to help teachers, you know, share their own lessons and stories with children and expand that. So thank you, Kathy, for being part of that today.
Thank you.
The other side of the garden. I know it's hot, but it's a beautiful walk. happy. We are so humbled by your support. Thank you so much for being here.
Thank you, everyone.